Morning. Aren't you glad that everything that you do and everything that you try in life prospers? Yeah, me too. I like one thing every now and then to happen. But we're going to look at a scripture today that tells us what we need to do to prosper. And that is going to be Psalm 1, 1 through 3. If you read this with me. The scripture says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers." But listen to this. He says, "But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and all he does, he prospers." When you look at that verse, at first it says, well, if I could just read scripture, then everything that I'm going to do in life is going to prosper and succeed. But that's not what he's talking about here. The psalmist is talking about a real life change, not to be focused on our life and not to be focused on ourselves and what we can accomplish in life, but it's to be focused on God's word, to meditate on it, to seek him and his will and his purpose. He's talking about a life change to where we're not self-centered, but we're God-centered and other-centered, that we are turned towards God and we're seeking him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. When we do that, then we find that all that we have before Christ, all that we have sought in our life has just been to fill ourselves, but it's not the true purpose in our life. But when we seek him and seek his will, it is a life change. And when we're going through that life change and when we're seeking him with all of our heart, everything that we do will prosper because we're seeking him and his perfect will for our life. So let us pray and let us meditate on that today. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. And we thank you that you do have a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. That if we would surrender to you fully, that we would seek you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, Lord, that we would make you first in our life, that we would seek the welfare of others above ourselves, Lord, that you would show us what our purpose is and that everything would prosper, no matter the situation, that we would bear fruit for you. So be with us, guide us, and direct us, and we'll give you the glory. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand with me as we're going to sing the familiar song, Glorious Day.
One day when heaven's filled with his praises, one day when sin dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he just freed me forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day, a glorious day, a glorious day, a glorious day.
I love that picture of worship that song gives to us, this idea of absolute holiness of God. And so all children, before I get ahead of myself, all children going to children's church may exit to my right. And if you have your Bibles, let's go to Luke chapter 2. Together this morning, I want to say thank you to Sarah and Andrew in leading. We miss Dan and we miss Patty, but you two did a fantastic job. Thanks as always to Josh running our AV stuff over here. As we continue this series, I just want to give a quick reminder. If you miss any Sunday or Wednesday, you can go to our church's YouTube page and everything from this series will be there. as well. But as we look now, as we looked at the birth narrative last week, now we're going to look at the only story that we have really from Jesus' childhood in Luke chapter 2. And we've entitled this message, Growing in Favor with God and with Man. And if you would like to follow along with this sermon outline, there is a QR code for you. If you use your camera, it'll take you right to the Bible app and the notes. But as we look at this, we want to understand that we have an identity crisis in this country. Right? So many people just don't know, who am I? Why am I here? And it's because our starting point has become our feelings and our emotions rather than truth. Specifically God's truth. We're forfeiting this. And when we make emotional decisions, bad decisions are the result. So this morning, the plan is to ask and answer this question. Where's the starting point for me learning who I am and why am I here? This is what we want to understand together. So before we look at the scripture, would you pray with me? Our Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you. And God, we simply ask that you would be with us. We thank you that as last week we studied that you are Emmanuel, God with us. But God, we're asking that your Holy Spirit would meet with us this morning. That he would make his presence very evident in all that we do. As we study your word, God, would you give us ears to hear and hearts to receive the truth of your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Trusting that you found Luke chapter 2, I'm going to ask you to stand as we honor the reading of God's word. Beginning in verse 41. The word says, Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up according to custom. And when the feast was ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it. But supposing him to be in the group, they went a day's journey. But then they began to search for him among their relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching for you in great distress. And he said to them, Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house? And they did not understand the saying that he spoke to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. This is God's word. You may be seated. Again, it's this last verse that we're taking the title from the text. It is, in fact, the focal point. What does it mean to increase in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man? And so our one big thing this morning is that God is more concerned with who we are becoming in Christ than what we do for Christ. Who you are matters more than what you do. And this is part of how we learn to solve this identity crisis. So what does it mean to grow in favor with God and man? Well, it requires first and foremost to seek and follow godly examples. Mary and Joseph are devout Jews. Clearly, they've got a desire to honor God and to obey his commands. We see this all the way back before Jesus was born. The angel comes to Mary and says, You are going to bear a son. He's going to be the Son of God. And understandably, she struggles to wrap her mind around this. She goes, How's this possible? I'm a virgin. And so the angel tells her, This is how it's going to happen. And so she's struggling to wrap her mind around it, but she accepted it. And we know it because in Luke 1:38, she says this, May it be to me according to your word. In other words, whatever God has declared, I'm good with it. Okay, then we study about Joseph. The Bible says that he is a righteous man. He finds out his fiancée is pregnant. He knows he's not the father. He's like, I don't know what to do. So he decides, because he's a righteous guy, he's not going to publicly shame her. He said, I'm going to divorce her quietly. Right? And it's not until an angel of God intervenes, says, no, she's not lying to you. It's okay. Marry her. Everything's fine. And what does he do? He does exactly according to what the angel says. So clearly they believe in the supernatural revelation of God. When God speaks, they listen. But more importantly, we see that they also believe in the natural revelation of God. That is his word. What I want us to understand as we kind of get going this morning is simply this. From Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, it is all the word of God. It is all equally inspired, and it is all for the glory of God and ultimately his children's good. There's not a single part of the Bible that doesn't matter. Okay? So we have to understand this. So Leviticus chapter 12, because everybody loves to study the book of Leviticus, right? By the way, we're going to do it later this year, Lord willing. At least part of it. But Leviticus 12 says every Jewish male is to be circumcised on the eighth day. So the first 7 days, the woman is considered unclean because of the blood. On the eighth day, the child is to be presented for circumcision in the temple. Then the woman goes through another 33-day cleansing period. So 40 days total. At the end of that period, that child is to be presented in the temple. Well, if you go back and look in Luke chapter 2, guess what Mary and Joseph do? Exactly according to that. The eighth day, Jesus is circumcised. 40 days later, he is presented in the temple. So clearly, Mary and Joseph love God, and they want to set a good example of what it means to be godly to Jesus. Now, it's kind of interesting because Jesus is God himself, right? But as parents, I want you to understand you have tremendous influence over your children, at least in the early years of their life. But it's not just about what you say. See, our faith is more caught than it is taught. In other words, our children will watch what we do more than listen to what we say. And any parent can tell you that, because when you ask your child, hey, take out the trash or walk the dog, do you just tell them once it gets done instantly? By the way, if you do, you're a unicorn. Like, but they watch what we do. So theology is more caught than it is taught. So this is why, mom and dad, you and I have such a tremendous responsibility from God to make sure that we are pursuing holiness, not just publicly, but also privately in our home. In fact, our first disciples that we make are our children. So we have to understand this. Now, does this mean mom and dad have to be perfect? I certainly hope not, because if so, we're in a whole lot of trouble right now. But this is what it does mean. When you and I, mom and dad, when we fall short of the glory of God, when we sin, we have a tremendous opportunity to model the gospel for our children. We have an opportunity to teach them in that moment by confessing our sin, by asking for their forgiveness if our sin is against them. Mom and dad, you ever been stressed out from a day and you snapped at your kids? Have you ever accused them of something that they actually didn't do? Now, a lot of times we as parents go, well, I'm not going to go say sorry to my kid because that's going to set a bad precedent. No, not asking for the forgiveness is setting a bad precedent. It's teaching them, don't take personal responsibility. So when you sin and when you harm your children, which you will do, you need to go to them and go, listen, mom and dad just messed up. I sinned. Use the word sin. We want them to grow up with hearing that word. I sinned against God, and I hurt you. Please forgive me. By the way, your children will not look and think less of you from doing that. They will go, wow, you can admit that you are wrong? I promise. It will change it. But then here's the key. Show them what repentance looks like by doing it differently. Right? Remember, theology is more caught than it is taught. So when we do the same thing over and over and over and we keep going, I'm sorry, but there's no change, then they don't learn the meaning of the word repentance. Okay, so we want to make sure that we use this, but this isn't just about moms and dads. As Christians, the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:21 that we are ambassadors for Christ. That is, you and I, church, we are the visible representation of the invisible God to the world around us. That is our calling, to demonstrate His glory. Jesus says that the church is to be salt and light. We are to be different than the world around us. So as Christians, this means we have to pursue holiness. We have to reflect the person and character of our Father who is in heaven. You know, the Apostle Paul, again, 1 Corinthians 11, he says, follow me as I follow Christ. Paul says, my life's not about me, it's about God. So I want you to follow me as I follow Christ. And so we want to wrestle with this question, whether we're parents or you know, just as Christians. Number one, are we following Jesus ourselves? Or are we actually living what we say we believe? And can God use our life to draw others to Himself? And if not, this isn't meant as a condemnation. Rather, this is rather meant for us to go, hey, I need to confess and repent of something. Right? Because we never outgrow the need for confession and repentance, do we? We're always falling short of the glory of God. Now, we're already forgiven. We're already secured by the grace of God. Hallelujah. Thank you. But we have a tremendous opportunity to show the world something different. And this is how God is glorified. So we want to make sure that we have godly examples to follow, but also that we are being a godly example that others can follow. If our children followed in our footsteps, would it lead them into the presence of God and the example of Christ? That's a question we want to wrestle with, right? But if I want to grow in favor with God and man, it also means I've got to know my identity. I have to know whose I am. Now, this is where we come to what I think is the most humorous part of this entire story. Okay, it might just be me. I'm okay with that. But as a parent, I can absolutely relate to what happened in this story. So Passover is over. Mary and Joseph and their group, they're headed home. Now, in those days, it wasn't just one family that would walk places. It was dangerous. So really, big groups of people. And the men would walk in the front. The women and children would often be in the back. Again, it's safety purposes here, okay? So Mary thinks Jesus is with Joseph. Joseph thinks Jesus is with Mary. And they go an entire day and don't know where Jesus is. Like, they lost God. Like, that, again, maybe it's just me, but that's funny. Like, the omnipresent God who's everywhere can't be found. Anyway, all right. So, it takes them a full day to realize, hey, Jesus isn't with us. All right, we got a problem. So, what do they start doing? Well, they immediately start looking for Him. And here's the thing. By the way, if you are here as a parent, and you have never lost track of your child for 3 minutes or 3 hours, or you've never lost track of them at all, you're a unicorn. Like, children just run off, okay? And we as dads, I'm going to pick on us, we're not always the most observant people in the world, okay? So 3 days, though. All right, so I want us to feel this for a moment. You and I know how the story ends. Mary and Joseph are living this out in real time. Can you imagine the panic that has to set in? Here's a 12-year-old who is lost in a big city. Okay, it's even bigger because everybody has come to Jerusalem for Passover. And they're searching. And it takes you 3 days to find him. Now, I'll say this. Several years ago, one of our sons was in the hospital for about 4.5 days. And I got to tell you, those were 4 of the longest nights of my life. And I knew exactly where he was. Mary and Joseph had no idea. Can you imagine how long night 1 and night 2 had to be? Can you imagine the anxiety that has to be building in there? Because this is my child, and I can't find him. Now they find him, and he's sitting in the temple, and he's asking questions. By the way, that is how they taught in those days. The rabbis would ask questions to get you thinking, and then they would teach you what the Word of God says. It's one of the reasons that in the summertime around here, we do the Bible question and answer. We want to know what's on your mind so that we can go to the Scriptures. So this is what Jesus is doing. And so Mary and Joseph walk into the temple, and there he is sitting with the rabbis. I imagine as a parent, again, I've felt this, it's a mixture of emotions between anger and relief. And I think you can see that in Mary's question. Son, why did you do this to us? I'm not the one that left. You left me. Right? But here it is. This, why did you do this? And so then Jesus makes one of the most powerful statements for the very first time in the Gospels. At 12 years old, he says, didn't you know I needed to be in my Father's house? For the first time in the Gospels, Jesus says, God is my Father. At 12 years old, Jesus knew exactly who he was. Now, he's 12 years old, humanly speaking. He's the eternal Son of God, so it's a little different. But he knew who he was. And Jesus' response isn't disrespectful, no matter what the show The Chosen tries to tell you. Okay, when Jesus says, didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house? He's not disrespecting his parents. He's not disowning Joseph here. He's not going, you're not my daddy. Rather, he's simply stating what he knows to be true. God is my Father, and I've been sent here to do my Father's will. See, some of your translations, whereas the ESV says, I must be in my Father's house, some of your translations say, I must be about my Father's business. They mean the same thing, okay? So what this means for you and I is this. We need to remember whose we are. If you have surrendered to the gospel, if you have been a born-again child of God, that is your identity. Not what do my mom and dad think about me? What do my peers think about me? What does my boss think about me? Who am I according to God? That's where our identity starts. See, when we make it anything else, then we go over to the world of Facebook and Instagram, right? And we've all seen all those pictures and all those likes, and people get hot takes, right? They got a comment on every story that ever comes out. By the way, did you notice in 2019 when COVID began, did you notice how people suddenly became experts on every virus ever known to man overnight? Okay. But everybody wants to be smart. I want to say something profound. So people go, ooh, look at this. How about we stay in our lane? Why do we post all of our thoughts? Why do we do these hot takes? Why do we take all these pictures? Because we have an unnecessary, unhealthy attraction to me. Like me, love me, think I'm smart. Tell me all of these things. It's an identity crisis. Right? This is what's happening. If we have trusted in the gospel, you have been adopted by God. You are a child of God. That is your identity. You are a child of the King. And this changes everything. God is your Father. We're all aware of stories of teenage boys and teenage girls making decisions because they want to be loved, or they want to be liked, or they want to fit in, right? And we know how those decisions typically end. Why do they make these sinful choices? Because they have no idea who they are. But now, before we start banging on teenagers, can we be honest? We as adults make some of the same choices. Right? Like, how many bad decisions have you and I made because we were trying to be liked? Because we wanted to fit in? Because we wanted somebody to love us? When a Christian doesn't know who they are, it leads to compromise. It leads you to make decisions that you know inherently are sinful. But because you have a desire to be loved and to be liked and to be accepted, you rationalize it away. And I know you do because I've done it, and we always use this phrase, I know I shouldn't, but. It's a statement of compromise in that moment. For somebody who's trying to be loved, they think, God, I have to do all of this and this and this and this, and I have to be a good person. I've got to do enough good things so that you will love me. Now, honestly, a lot of that is born out of your relationship with your parents, right? You had to earn their love. You were never confident that just being you, mom and dad would love you. Right? And so you work for their approval, and so now you bring it into the spiritual world. Now you're trying to earn God's love. So if that is where you are this morning, I want to say something that I hope liberates you. You will not and cannot be loved any more by God than you are right now. God will not love you more if you get it all right, and He will not love you any less if you get it all wrong. Because God's love is not determined based on what we do. It is based on who He is. Stop trying to earn what God's already given you. We see this over and over. Well, I got to do it. And what happens when we sin? We start to feel unlovable. Right? Well, How can I do this? It's easy to feel like God's going to reject us. Like God's just done with us because, well, I messed up this one time. I said this in Sunday school. I've said it in sermons before. One of the most comforting things for me to know is this. God's sovereign plan has already factored in every stupid decision I'm going to make. God is not sitting in heaven going, wow, I didn't see that coming. He already knew it. God is not going to reject us because we sin. We get around a group of people at work, or maybe our kids' sporting events or gym or wherever. And they start saying, doing things that go against Scripture. And we know we should say something, but I just want to be liked. And so what do? We stay silent. Because we're not confident in who I am. I have to be liked by you. I have to be approved by you. And so I stay silent. It happens in churches too. Right? We see over and over that the Bible gets attacked. And so what do? Churches will water down Scripture to make God and the Bible more palatable to people. Right? Because we're not confident that God and the gospel is enough. So it's important that you're confident in who you are. Everybody's got an opinion of you. But you know who really matters? There's only one opinion that truly matters, and that's the one who created you, who called you, who was crucified for you, and who you will stand before one day in judgment. His name is Jesus Christ. Listen, people's opinion of you is going to change. When you do what they want you to do, they'll love you. The moment you push back or do something they don't like, suddenly they don't like you. Have you ever seen middle school friendships? Have you ever seen middle school and high school dating? Oh, I love him, I hate him. I love him, I hate him. I love him, I hate him. By the way, it happens in the adult world too. I'm married, we're divorced. I'm married, we're divorced. What's happening? What's happening is we're forgetting who we're supposed to please. When I make my marriage about Diana either pleasing me or me pleasing her, I have fundamentally forgotten God's purpose in marriage. Purpose of marriage is not for me to be satisfied or for me to please her. The purpose of marriage is for God to conform me to the image of Christ so that I am prepared to live with him for all of eternity. Marriage isn't about my happiness as much as it is about my holiness. And so we see this over and over and over. But when I come to surrender and understand the gospel, then this is what God says. I am forgiven, I am redeemed, I am loved, I am secured, and nothing and no one will ever change that. I am a child of the King. Know whose you are. Closely tied to that is this: know your purpose. You know, one of the most interesting things in the text, back in the very beginning of it, okay, verse 43, and when the feast was ended and they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. Jesus was intentional about staying in Jerusalem. This wasn't a, hey, I thought he was with you. No, I thought he was. No. Jesus said, no, I'm staying right here. Why? Because he knew why he came. If you're going to grow in favor with God and man, you must first belong to God. And then you have to go and show God to man by how you live. But it's got to be that surrender first, that I belong. Jesus said he was about his Father's business. We read throughout the Gospels Jesus saying, I'm doing what the Father does, or I'm doing what the Father sent me to do. He was intentional about how he lived. Jesus knew why he had come. He came to show the glory of God and to redeem sinners. Listen, you may not, some of you are still young, and I'll clue you in on this. Even as adults, we don't always know why we exist, right? But let me go ahead and share it with you. You exist for the glory of God. Your life is to point to the glory of God in everything that we do. So whether you are a business person or a lawyer or a doctor or whatever it is, we do it for the glory of God. That's why we were created. That's why we exist. Now, the interesting thing about this text is we don't know what Jesus and the other rabbis were discussing. But there are clues in there that will let us know. Pretty good option. Okay? So, there's two clues. The first one is, when did this happen? Well, it says right in the opening, at the time of Passover. Right? What is Passover? You go back into Exodus. It's the time where God delivered Israel from slavery in Egypt. All right? Passover is synonymous with redemption. So that's part of it. But how many of you also are aware of this, that when the Bible names a number, it's there for a purpose? If it gives you a number or a place, it's always there for a purpose. So what number is used in this text? The number 3, right? As in 3 days, Mary and Joseph were looking for Jesus. So again, in the Hebrew alphabet, in the Greek alphabet, numbers mean something. And so we see here, well, what could the number 3 mean? Well, let's look at how the number 3 is used throughout Scripture. If you go to Genesis chapter 1, the creation account, the third day is the only one that is doubly blessed. God says, and it was good, twice, only time in the creation account, on third day. All right, go to Genesis chapter 22. Abraham is told, take your only son Isaac to a mountain I will show you. How many days did Abraham and Isaac and the servants walk until they saw the mountain? 3 days. They go up that mountain. Well, what does God do? God provides a substitute for Isaac on that mountain. And so in that way, Isaac is being restored to his father. All right, so we got redemption and restoration. Let's go a little bit further. In the book of Exodus, God has delivered Israel from slavery, Passover. They get to the base of Mount Sinai. God says, I want you to purify yourself for, take a guess how many days? 3 days. And then Moses, I want you to climb up the mountain and I'm going to give you the law of God. What is the law of God? It is freedom. It is freedom for the nation of Israel to know if I do these things, then I will please and be in a right relationship. One more. Two more. Jonah. Now, we always sing this song from VeggieTales, right? Jonah was a prophet, but he never really got it, right? You're welcome. All right, so Jonah. Jonah is running from God. Finally, the pagan sailors go, whoop, overboard. He's drowning. All of a sudden, the Bible says God prepared, God sent a great fish to swallow up Jonah. What does that fish represent? Redemption. Right? That if the fish doesn't swallow Jonah, he's drowned. Right? Now, refresh my mind, please. How many days was Jonah in the heart of the big fish? 3. By the way, do you know Jesus pointed to that as a sign of his death and resurrection? He said, as Jonah was in the heart of the great fish 3 days and three nights, so too will the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth. So the number 3 gives us this: freedom, redemption, and restoration. It is what it is meant when we read here. So let's put it together. Passover time, redemption, along with this number 3. What is Jesus talking about with these rabbis? He's most likely talking about how God has come to them in order to redeem them and set them free, to give them a right relationship with God. Jesus is talking with his rabbis about who he is and why he's come. I've come to save you. I've been sent from my Father to redeem you. This is why they're astonished, because a 12-year-old boy is going, what? Who is this kid? But what does this have to do with us? Well, if you're here and you've never surrendered to Jesus, you need to understand that he is the only way for you to be right with God. He is the only way that you can have freedom in this life. It is the only way that you can be restored to a right relationship now and forever with God. Your purpose in life is not to get rich. It's not to have a long life. It's not even really about being happy. The Westminster Shorter Catechism in question 1 says, what is the chief end of man? Answer, the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Jesus did not save us to sit sour and soak. Jesus saved us so that we can have a relationship with him, not only in the future, but now. John 10:10, I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. It goes back to Psalm 1. How do we have a blessed life? We turn from sin and we meditate and walk in the word and ways of God. This is what he's getting at. You were created by God and for God. Colossians 1:16 tells us. Your purpose is bigger than anything this world can ever offer you. Your purpose is bigger than even yourself. What is my purpose? A lot of times, especially in church circles, we love to give the Christianese answers, right? My purpose is to make disciples of all nations. That sounds great, but it's wrong. See, making disciples is what I do. My purpose is who I am. My purpose is to know the one true God and to experience him deeper and deeper in fellowship, in love, in a growing relationship. How do I experience Him deeper? By obeying Him. We talk about what our mission or our vision as a church is. We exist for the glory of God, to know God deeper so that we can make Him known broadly. But the emphasis is on that knowing Him deeper. I don't want to just read about God. I want to experience Him. I want that life-transforming power flowing in me and through me. And as I do, I'm going to naturally go and tell other people. When you find a restaurant that you like, do you keep it to yourself? You go tell everybody. So when we have truly come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we don't keep it to ourselves. We share it. We tell others. And the more we see God doing in our life, the more we tell Him. You know, think about just this time last week. We prayed multiple times for two young people, a young girl named Lauren and a young man by the name of Rylan. If you see pictures of these accidents, guys, there's no reason that either one of them is still alive apart from the grace and sovereignty of God. And we've been getting updates throughout the week. Hey, they're walking, they're sitting up, they're sipping, they're doing all of these things. We're telling everybody. Why? Because we're excited. What is God doing in your life right now that you're excited about? Who have you told? Who have you shared it with? Our purpose is to know God. And the more I know Him, the more I'm going to want to tell other people about Him. But I got to know Him first. So have you begun that journey of knowing God, which requires an admission that I have sinned by rejecting His love? I'm trying to be good enough. I'm trying to get to heaven on my own. And turning from that and understanding that it is only by the grace of God through the death, burial, and resurrection that I can be saved. Have you surrendered to that? Because nothing else matters until that moment. That's what we pray. We've been praying all week that there would be people here. There are going to be people watching this later on who would truly repent of their sin and be born again. But the gospel isn't just for the saved. Maybe there's some of you Christians here this morning that are having an identity crisis yourself. You're trying to be light. You're trying to rationalize decisions that you know God says are wrong. We talked about in Sunday school, Samson. There's a story, there's a verse in chapter 16, verse 2. And it says that Samson did not know that the Spirit of God left him. The reality is this morning that if you and I are living in sin, the hand of blessing of God is not going to be on us. But the way to get that back is to not only confess that we have sinned, that we have turned from God, not that He's forsaken us, that we have forsaken Him, and then start walking the other way. It's what the Bible calls repentance. I can't just go, hey, Lord, I sinned, I'm sorry. We got to take the steps to go the other way. So if you're in the midst of an identity crisis right now, if you're struggling with something, it's as simple as confessing and repenting. And here's the promise of God. When we do it, He will not turn us away. God will never say to His child, that was too far, I'm done with you. But at the same time, we won't feel His Spirit, we won't feel His presence, we won't have that blessing in our life until we confess and we repent. So that's the call this morning. Would you stand with me as we're going to pray together? Our Father, in Jesus' name, we come to You grateful for Your love and for Your grace. For it is only because of Your love and grace that we can be forgiven.